Oh, what a change in my life. The Holy Ghost on the inside, working on the outside. Oh, what a change in my heart. The Holy Ghost on the inside, working on the outside. Oh, what a change in my heart. The Holy Ghost on the inside, working on the outside. Oh, what a change in my heart. Oh, what a change in my life. I greet you in Jesus Christ's name. It's a blessing to have you tune in with us on this evening. I usually don't come before you on Thursday. I usually come on Wednesday, but you know, hey, praise God. We're still on our post. Praise God, trying to hold up the bloodstained banner anyhow, anyway. Praise God. And no matter what day it is, what time it is, the Lord is worthy to be praised. Praise God. I greet you. Once again, my name is Pastor David Brian Gray, and I'm honored of the Lord to be with you on today. Praise God. We've been studying the book of Proverbs, which has been coming in the division of the Bible or the Old Testament, known as the books of poetry. Praise God, the books of poetry. And so we've been in this the last couple of weeks, and we're going to just keep on plugging along in it because the book of Proverbs is so rich and so powerful for your everyday life. Praise God. And I want to send a shout out to so many people who have tuned in and have been tuning in to this ministry, this opportunity to study the Word of God. Praise the Lord. This is power in and power from, or I should say power from and power in the Word of God. Power in and power from the Word of God. Praise the Lord. And so I'm just glad so many people have been tuning in and letting me know that this has been a blessing in their life. And I want you to understand something. When you get the Word of God down in your soul, praise God, it can change the outside of your life. Not only does it work on the inner man, but it also works on the outer man. Praise God. And so we are going to jump into this word, praise God, and find out what the Lord has for you and I. Amen. Hallelujah. There is a name I love to hear. I love to sing its worth. It sounds like music in my ear. The sweetest name on earth. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Sing it, oh. How I love Jesus, because he first loved me. It tells me of a Savior's love who died to set me free. It tells me of his precious blood, the sinner's perfect plea. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Sing it, oh, how I love Jesus, because he first loved me. It tells me what my Father hath in store for every day. And though I tread a darksome path, it yields sunshine all the way. Oh, how I love Jesus. Singing, oh, how I love Jesus. Singing, oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. It tells of one whose loving heart can feel my deepest woe, who in each sorrow bears a part that none can bear below. Help me, come on, oh, how I love Jesus. Do you love him? Oh, how I love Jesus. Sing it, oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Praise the living God. Do you know that the Lord loved you? Praise God. Hallelujah. He loved you while you were stuck in your mess, in your sin. Praise God. In darkness, we are born in sin and born to sin. But God loved us so much that he gave his only begotten son. I want to send a shout out to Sister Susan in Florida and my good brother. My goodness, I ain't seen him in a couple of years, but praise God, I salute him. Minister Derek Franklin there in Michigan. Praise God. Hallelujah. Oh man, he used to be my supervisor, somewhat my supervisor there at UPS. Praise God. That's a great man of God. Loves the Lord. Praise God and respect him. And we're just so honored that he is tuning in. Praise God. Hallelujah. Oh, I'm excited. If you get an opportunity, please don't forget to share this. Praise God. Usually I'm on Wednesday nights, but I had to do something, praise God, last night, and so I'm on tonight, but praise God, we're going to stand on our post. Don't forget what's going on. The Lord is blessing, and he's moving by his Holy Spirit. Praise God. Don't forget to call your friends, your family, call your enemies, and tell them Reverend Gray is on Facebook. I'm on Instagram. Praise God. And we're looking to go even further and farther in the name of the Lord. Praise God. We got Florida on. We got Michigan on. Praise God. There's been times we've had California on. California. We've had New Jersey on. We've had Illinois on, Michigan on, even over in England. Hallelujah. Praise God. And then I'm looking for, I don't know if he'll be in, praise God, him and the other brethren in West Africa, Nigeria, Botswana, Kenya, Togo, Africa. I got minister friends in Togo, Africa, and Kampala. Praise God. Hallelujah. And so we're just tickled pink that the Lord is using us. But listen, we're not going to delay the time. We're going to go right into the word of the living God, because that's where the power is from, the word of the living God. Proverbs is the book we've been studying. Let's have a word of prayer and we'll delve into the book. Get your Bibles out, get your pen out, get your paper out. I've been sending out the worksheets. Praise God. I've been sending out the worksheets. If you don't have it, well, that's because I messed up. I'm going to just tell you right now, I messed up. But they should be in your inbox, in your email, as of 30 minutes ago. Amen. Praise God. But anyway, you get a chance, play this back over again, and it'll be a blessing. The other worksheets, I sent them out to you last week. Praise God. We're going to keep on pushing in the book of Proverbs. I want you to understand something. Wisdom, the Bible says wisdom is the principal thing. Hallelujah. And listen, it don't say riches. It doesn't say riches. It doesn't say this and that. It says wisdom is the principal thing. And with all thy getting, get understanding. And the beginning of wisdom is the fear of the Lord. The beginning of wisdom. So if you see the society like it's living now, people are living a nickel worth of dog meat. People are living raggedy as a can of sauerkraut. People are, listen here, listen, if it feels good, baby, do it. Do your thing. It's your thing. Do what you want to do. I can't tell you who to sock it to. That's how people are living now. They're living any old kind of way because they act like, listen, but listen, let me tell you something. Real wisdom starts with a fear of the Lord. Listen, I fear God right now, and I also fear that I will have to stand before him one day. We all will. Every tub got to, like my grandmama used to say, every tub, baby, got to sit on its own bottom. And so it's appointed unto men once to die, and after this, the judgment. Listen here, you and I, me and you, us, we're going to have to stand before God and give an account for how we live. Whether we live for God or did not live for God, you got to give an account to him. The Bible says the books were open. Hallelujah. And whosoever's name was not found written in the Lamb's book of life was cast. The door wasn't open. Praise God. You just go on that. Yeah, go that way. Just go. Yeah, just keep going. Keep going? Yeah, just keep going. No, they were cast into the lake of fire. Hallelujah. But I ain't going. Praise God. And listen here. You ain't going either, right? Amen. All right, let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for tonight. We thank you for your people that are watching. Master, I thank you for what you're doing in the lives of the people. Lord God, we pray in the name of Jesus for growth. We pray for the favor of God. We pray for the power of God to work and move in our life. Lord God, transforming and changing us is the new creatures in Christ Jesus. Heavenly Father, we need wisdom today. And your word says, he that lacketh wisdom, let him ask of God. So tonight, Lord God, we're asking you, we beseech you, and we call upon your name to ask you to move by your spirit in this study tonight as we go into the word of God. Give us wisdom, give us clarity, give us understanding, give us the growth that we need to be able to bear our burdens in the heat of the day, to be able to stand strong in the name of the Lord, and to be able, Lord God, to share light, Lord God, in this dark time that we're living in. We give you the praise. We give you the glory. We give you the honor in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. All right. Once again, we're in the book of Proverbs. Now, I've been telling you, you already kind of know it. I'm sure if you've been reading the Word of God, you know that Solomon wrote most of the book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs comes in the division of the Old Testament known as the books of poetry. Praise God. Not poetry that rhymes and moves the heart, but poetry that is didactic. That Hebrew word means to teach you something, to instruct you. And so the book of Proverbs is instrumental in a believer's walk in your life for God. Because see, I want you to understand something. You're not going to spend all your time in church. Let's be honest. Most of real living is outside of the church. But the Word of God is here to help us. The Word of God is there for every situation. Listen, I'm going to keep claiming it. The Word of God answers every question that will come up in your heart concerning life, concerning raising your children, concerning how you interact with your wife, your husband, how you interact in church or outside of the church, what to do with your money, what to do in the future, where, what your purpose is, why God made you, why did God do. The Word of God answers the question. And the book of Proverbs, and what is a proverb? Well, I'm glad you asked that question. The word proverb comes from the Hebrew word masal, which means, it's a root meaning, which means to be like, to be like. So in other words, what the proverbalist is saying is, don't act like this. This is how you ought to act. This is how you ought to be. This is how you ought to carry yourself. And he gives us examples. For instance, he tells us, be careful of hanging out, going out with the crowd, going out with them, because all they want to do is shed blood. All they want to do is crook and snook and fake and shake and perpetrate. All they're trying to do is to, they can't even sleep, the Bible says. The book of Proverbs says they can't even rest. They can't even get no good snoozing off until they have wreaked havoc in somebody's life. And so, as I said, the word proverb comes from the Hebrew word masal, which means to be like. Don't be like that, but be like this. Or in other words, this is what God wants you to be like. You must understand, even though there is a human writer of every book in the Bible, Solomon being the writer of Proverbs, it's the Holy Ghost that gives us the word of the living God. And the Holy Ghost is giving us what God is saying, Holy Ghost being God, what God is saying for you and I today. This book of Proverbs was written hundreds and hundreds of years ago, but I guarantee you, it speaks to us in the 21st century. With the new iPhone 3 or 12 or what 15, whatever it is, with the new Android, with the 4K HD screen television with the 1080 pixels, it still speaks to us today. Where we've got Alexa, Alexa, could you turn off my lights? Alexa, can you raise the garage door? Alexa, can you do this for me? Alexa, can you do it? The word of God still speaks to us today, just as powerful and just as vivid as it did when it was first written. Hallelujah. The book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs also, in a sense, is like dark sayings. Dark sayings. All right. And I'll give you some examples about this as we go on. I've said to you in previous Bible studies about the book of Proverbs, there are four key verses in the book of Proverbs. Just like every book in the Bible, I want to send a shout out to my friend, Pastor Benjamin. God bless you. Good to see you. Praise God. There in California. Praise God. The book of Proverbs, or I should say, every book in the Bible has a key verse in it, or key verses. The book of Proverbs has four of them. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5 and 6, trust in the Lord with all thine heart, lean not to thine own understanding, and all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. Turn with me to chapter 4, verse 7. You'll find the third one. The third key verse is verse 7. Wisdom is the principal thing. Isn't it something? Listen here, I don't care what city you go to. Everybody's talking about what's going on in the news. They're talking about Bitcoin. They're talking about Dogecoin. They're talking about the latest stocks. They're talking about what's going on with Jeff Bezos and all of that. Talking about all of that stuff. But God's word here says in verse 7 of chapter 4, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. And with all thy getting, get understand. Notice it doesn't say get a degree. Not that there's nothing wrong with getting a degree. Go as far in education as you can. But understand something. You only got a degree. In other words, a smidgen of education. God has all knowledge. God has all power. Praise God. And I don't care how many degrees you have, you will never, ever, ever, never, ever, and there'll never, ever, ever, never, ever be anyone who has as much knowledge as God. And God says here, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get understanding. The third, I should say, the fourth key verse is in chapter 9. Come on with me. Chapter 9, look at verse 10. The fear, we talked about that a little bit earlier. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. Once again, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the holy is understanding. Praise God. We're talking tonight about the book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs. Come on, let's look at it. It has 31 chapters. The book of Proverbs. It has 915 verses. The book of Proverbs. It has 43 words in it. The book of Proverbs. As I said, it was written hundreds and hundreds. It was written in 931 BC. Praise God. As I said, Solomon is the principal author of the book of Proverbs. You also have Agur, who is a scribe during the time of King Hezekiah. He also writes and is a contributor, if you will, to the book of Proverbs, praise God. And then we have as well King Lemuel, which probably and most likely is Bathsheba, praise God. And King Lemuel is not a different person. It is possibly a pet name that mama gave her baby Solomon. All right. She also contributes in chapter 31. The book of Proverbs is the 20th book in the Bible. It's the 20th book, of course, in the Old Testament. Its section is in, as I said, the Old Testament. It comes in the books of the poetry, as I told you before, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. And those are didactic poetry to teach us something, to instruct us. Praise God. You know, we do better with teaching than we do with preaching. There's nothing wrong with preaching. Preaching tells you what to do, but teaching shows you how to do it. Praise God. It gives you the mirror. Praise the Lord. All right. Let's go into this, then we'll go into our worksheet, and I'm going to then wrap it up. Solomon, the principal writer of Proverbs, it contains, however, he wrote 3,000 Proverbs, but this book here, Sister Susan, only contains 800 of his 3,000 Proverbs. 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 32 says, "And he spake 3,000 Proverbs, and his songs were 1,005. Isn't that something? My goodness, if Columbia Records and whoever else could have got a hold of Solomon, my goodness, what you talking about? Not Def Jam, y'all. We ain't talking about Def Jam Records and yeah. But anyway, he wrote 105 songs, praise God. His wisdom, listen to this here, his wisdom. It's in 1 Kings chapter 4. You can turn to it if you want to, or just write down the scripture and look it up later on. But listen to this. "And he spake of trees from the cedar tree that is in Lebanon, even unto the hyssop that springeth out of the wall. He spake also of beasts and of fowl and of creeping things and of fishes. And there came of all people to hear the wisdom of Solomon, from all kings of the earth which heard of his wisdom." Isn't that powerful? Proverbs chapter 25 verse 1 says, "These also are the proverbs of Solomon, which the men of Hezekiah, king of Judah, copied out." Listen here, isn't it something that King Hezekiah, and he had his own big time reputation. King Hezekiah was a big time king, praise God, for the nation of Israel. He allowed his men to gather the Proverbs of Solomon and include them here in the book of Proverbs. You'll find that in chapter 25. But I found that interesting because most kings are about making their own reputation, making their own way and doing their own thing, praise God. But here, King Hezekiah, he allowed his men or got his men together to gather the Proverbs of this king who lived before him by the name of Solomon. What is a proverb, Sister Susan? A proverb is a pithy, in other words, having substance and having a point to what it's saying. It's a pithy saying. It has substance to it. It uses comparisons. It uses contrasts. It uses analogies or observations or figures of speech. What? To get the point across. That's why we have the book of Proverbs, 31 chapters. Get into this book. Read this book. Praise God. I think the last time we left off at Proverbs chapter 10. Praise God. Pick it up and keep reading. Read through the book of Proverbs. That's your assignment, praise God. The book of Proverbs. All right, so now let's go into our lesson for tonight, and then we'll pick it up later. If you don't have I send it and put it in your email. You get an opportunity, go back to it and check it out. Praise God. But the book of Proverbs is looked at as the practical book for everyday living. Practical book for everyday living. I want you to understand something. God is not requiring some super complicated whatever else kind of life for us to live. God says, listen here, you live for me and I will bless you. You live for me and I will. Listen, God's word is apropos for the CEO of a high corporation as well as somebody who works out of the home, praise God. God's word is apropos because most of life is dealing with other people. It's not only dealing with other people, it's dealing with yourself or the questions that arise up in your soul, the things that arise up out of life. Who am I? Where am I going? What am I supposed to be doing? If you don't know family, where is my family? Or why did God save me? What do I do about sin? Why is the evil in the world? God's word answers those questions. Why is there evil in the world? What's going to happen to the evil? Why does it seem like the wicked always prospering? David asked that same question. He must admit, listen here, here's a man who sat on the throne of Israel. I want to send a shout out to Minister Elaine Banks. God bless you. Good to see you. Here is a man who sat upon the throne of Israel. Praise God. And God used him greatly. He still, with all of his military ability and being able to fight and do all that he could do, he sat on the throne and was a powerful king, praise God, and a rich king, praise God. He asked the question, why does it seem like the wicked are always prospering? You're going to have questions that arise up, whether it be about you directly or with your family, or something that's going on indirectly in the world. God's word answered the question. And so I said all that to let you know, praise God, that God's word gives us pithy, short sayings, understandings of how we're to live every day. Hallelujah. It ain't about us just living on Sunday. God wants you to live on Monday. God wants you to live on Tuesday and Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. God wants you to live for Him on every day. Whether you are, as I said, a CEO of a big corporation, you're the president of a bank, or whether you sweep the streets of some back alley somewhere, and it ain't about that. But God's word, praise God, speaks to us concerning everything that goes on in our life. So it's a practical book for everyday living. That's what the book of Proverbs is, a practical book for everyday living. And I want to just bring this out. Maybe I'll bring it out a little bit more later on next time. But the book of Proverbs talks about what to do for everyday living. The book of Job talks about what to do in suffering, how you ought to carry yourself in suffering. So every book in the Bible talks to us, but the book of the books of the section of poetry in the Old Testament speaks specifically about various occasions. All right. Anyway, going back to that, and I want to send a shout out to Brother Stephen Miner. God bless you. Good to see you, sir. Most of the book is written by Solomon, who wrote 3,000 Proverbs and 105 Psalms. He uses all different types of people, animals, bugs, objects such as gold, silver, the tongue, hell, food, clothes, alcohol, trees, plants, ships, and body parts just to drive his point home for the need for wisdom. Now, that's all the things you and I kind of interact with, like people, all different kinds of people you and I interact with. We come across, we need to take some examples from animals and bugs. You say, how do I take an example from an animal or a bug? You don't know what you're talking about. The Bible says, look at the ant, thou sluggard, thou lazy person, just tag. Won't even fail for why. You can take an example from a little tiny ant who doesn't rest in the summertime, is working and is diligent. He gives us examples of this. We go through things such as gold and silver. That would, you know, they had gold and silver then. We got money today or cash and that kind of thing. But that's still money, praise God. The tongue. Your tongue can mess you up. You have to be careful of your tongue. Hallelujah. Hell. The place of hell. What it has to do with that. Food. The Bible said, or the book of Proverbs talks about the pictures of silver in apples, pictures of silver and apples of gold or something like that. Anyway, it talks about food. I'm just going to let you know that. It talks about clothes, your clothes. It talks about alcohol, how wine is a mocker, how wine can mess you up. Praise God. It talks about trees. Proverbs chapter, a wholesome tongue. That's what it says. A wholesome tongue is a tree of life. What is a tree of life? The tree of life gives life. When I think about a tree, it's blossoming. It's got ripe, sweet fruit on it for me to eat and for me to grow in my body, to give my body the necessary nutrients and sustenance that I need. Well, a wholesome tongue, the Bible says, that we're using two objects that we interact with, like the tongue and trees. A wholesome tongue is a tree of life, but a perverse spirit, the Bible says, is the rottenness. It'll rotten your bones. In other words, if your tongue is filthy, and I'm not talking, and it's not talking about curse words, it's talking about, I'm not going to make it. I'm a dummy. I don't like this. I don't like that. Every word coming out your mouth is critical. Every word that you saying is low down and debilitating and derogatory. And I'm not talking about necessarily cursing when using four-letter words. I'm talking about people talking negatively. I'm going to be sick. I'm going to die early. My daddy died early, and I'm going to die early too. You keep talking that, baby, it's going to come to pass. Praise God. Hallelujah. Want to send a shout out to Minister Brickhouse. God bless you. Good to see you. All right. So, as I said, we're in the book of Proverbs. And so Solomon uses all these things that you and I come across in life and are a part of our life to teach us something for us to grow. Not only does he use trees and plants and ships and body parts, all right, just to drive his point home, he uses all of that. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 7 says, wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get understanding. God gives wisdom. James chapter 1, verse 5 says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. Now, turn with me to Proverbs chapter 9. Come on, y'all. Proverbs chapter 9. Look at verse 11. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 11. I hope you have your worksheet. If you don't, look in your inbox. It should be in your email inbox. Praise God. If it's too late, you whatever else, go back over it. Go just replay this later on and pull out that sheet, print it out, or pull it up on your tablet. Pull it up and go through it. Praise God. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 11. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 11 says, for by me thy days shall be multiplied. Who is this talking? This is wisdom talking. Remember, I said to you previously that wisdom is personified. God's wisdom is personified in a sense as of a woman. who is beautiful and alluring and is calling out to you to come and get wisdom. Come that you might grow. Come and taste of the wisdom of God that you don't have to die prematurely. And so Proverbs chapter 9 verse 11, wisdom is speaking to us and it says, "For by me thy days shall be multiplied and the years of thy life shall be increased." That's my wisdom, wisdom, wisdom. God can give you wisdom where it was slated for you to have a short life. God can give you the type of wisdom to live life that you extend your life, that your life is longer and prospers and increases. That's what God has for you. It's not the will of God for you to die prematurely. It's not the will of God for you to die before your time, praise God, and not for you to die broke and sick and busted and disgusted at 70, 80, 90 years old, you mad and crinkled up and wrinkled up, and not only on the outside but also on the inside. You're critical, you're angry, you're spiteful. Now, that's not the will of God. God would have for us to live a long, prosperous, joyous life where we enjoy our family, where we enjoy our life, where we enjoy whatever that we have that he has put in our hands. God, that's the will of God, praise God. And so Proverbs chapter 9, verse 11, wisdom is speaking out and calling out, and it says, "By me, for by me thy days shall be multiplied, and the years of thy life shall be increased." Now, in our worksheet, under the scripture, I've got Proverbs chapter 9, verse 11, and under the results, I've got long life. I don't know about you, but I want to live a long life. Praise God. Psalm 91 says, praise God, Psalm 91 goes along with it. I use that as my cross, as my cross reference verse. Listen to it. Psalm 91. And he shall call upon me because he has set his love upon me. Therefore will I deliver him. I will set him on high because he hath known my name. I shall call upon him and he will answer me. He will show me. I shall call upon him and he will answer me. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him. With long life will I satisfy him and show him my salvation. You have to understand something. Listen here. Real life and many things in life cannot be accomplished in just 2 years and 3 years. It takes a long life, and you're growing, and you're taking retrospect of your life and looking over things and such. Long, God wants his people to live a long life. Praise God. I'm not talking about, and some people say, well, you know, the Bible says that you'll live 70 years. That's the law. That's what the law said. Before that, before the law, God had for us to live 80 years and 90 years, praise God. Living a long life, praise God. And I'm not talking about a long life of sickness, a long life of disease. No, God wants you healed. God wants you healthy. God wants you strong in your mind. God wants you strong in your resolve, praise God. Caleb said, listen here, I'm just as strong now as I was back when God made the promise. He said, listen, I don't want no lot. They were delving out lots when the nation of Israel came into the land of Egypt, praise, land of Canaan. They were delving out lots among the tribes. Caleb said, God said that he was going to bless me. He was going to keep me around. Give me the mountain. I want the mountain, praise God. Hallelujah. I don't want no lot. All right, put a stake right there. All right, put a stake over here. Put one back over here. Put one over here. That's it. That's. Well, where am I supposed to be? That's it. That's all we got. And no, Caleb said, give me the mountain. Praise God. Hallelujah. I don't know about you, but God wants us to live a strong, well life. Praise God. All right, now go to Proverbs chapter 2. Proverbs chapter 2. Go with me. Come on, y'all. Come on. We studied in the Bible tonight. Come on. Proverbs chapter 2. Look at the word of the living God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Proverbs chapter 2, look at verse 20. That thou mayest walk in the way of good men and keep the paths of the righteous. For the upright shall dwell in the land, and the perfect shall remain in it. Now, that perfect means you don't make no mistakes. It means righteous in the eyes of God. All right. Shall remain in it. But the wicked shall be cut off from the earth, and the transgressor shall be rooted out of it. These three verses are talking about prosperity here. That thou mayest walk in the way of good men and keep the paths of the righteous. For the upright shall dwell in the land, and the perfect shall remain in it. But the wicked shall be cut off from the earth, and the transgressor shall be looted out of it. I came today to tell you that God wants you not only to live long life, but he wants you to prosper. It's the will of God for you to prosper. Job chapter 36. Come on, we're staying in the books of poetry. Go to Job chapter 36 for me, y'all. Come on, Sister Susan. Come on, Brother Brickhouse. Where are you at, Brother Steve? Did you leave me? Come on here, y'all. Go with me to Job chapter 36. Hallelujah. And look what it says in verse 11. Job 36, 11. If they obey and serve him, they shall spend their days in prosperity and their years in pleasures. Isn't that something? In other words, if you and I obey the Lord and follow his word, listen here, God can't help but bless you. God's got to bless you. God's word, he's even already put it in his word that there's blessing that comes with it. You don't believe me? Go back to when you get a chance, not right now, but go back to the book of Deuteronomy and turn to chapter 28 and see how God said, I'll bless you going in. I'll bless you coming out. I'll bless you in the city. I'll bless you in the field. I'll bless your crops. I'll bless your storehouse. I'll bless your livestock. I will bless you, praise God, if you follow me, if you keep my commandment, if you do my word, praise God. Then God says, and that's the first chapter, that's verse 1 through verse 14. Then God says, all right, if you don't follow me, if you don't keep my word, if you don't live right, he says, then I'll put all these curses on you. I'll put sickness and disease on you, and to the point where I'll annihilate you. He was talking to the whole nation of Israel. If you don't live with me, he says, I'm putting all these curses that I put on you, I'm going to put on you. And it's going to cause you to die off here. You're going to get sick over here. You're going to get squandered over here. You're going to lose money over here. God, but I want you to understand, God wants to bless us. Don't let nobody fool you. Talking about, oh, listen here. Now you see, God wants you broke. God wants you poor. God, that ain't it. And what Bible you read, whatever Bible you reading from, it's the wrong one. Because right here in Job 36, verse 11, he says, if they obey and serve him, they will spend their days in prosperity and their years in pleasures. Now you must understand something. God's word always has a condition. If you do this, then you get that. If you don't do this, then you don't get that. It's a condition with God's word. I want to send a shout out to my good friend in Michigan, Pastor Evans. God bless you, Apostle Evans. Good to see you. God bless you. But there's a condition, and people don't understand that. There's a condition with tithing. There's a condition with living right. You got to live right. You can't live a nickel worth of dog meat, raggies, a can of sauerkraut, and be surprised because stuff is coming up on you and knocking you silly and knocking you crazy and you can't half make it and can't get two pennies to rub together. You've got to, first of all, you got to start tithing and giving and supporting the ministry. And when people start hearing that, they say, oh, the preacher talking about money. And listen, I'm trying to talk about money and prosperity to bless you, to help you, to see you through, to get the Because see, if we don't tithe, then we don't give. If we don't support, if we don't obey him, then there's a curse that comes with it. He says it, I set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that both thee and thou seed may live. This ain't just about you, baby. This is about your children. This is about your family. This is about your grandchildren. This is about your great-great-grandchildren. Praise God. If they obey and serve him, they'll spend their days in prosperity and their years in pleasures. Come on, y'all. Go with me to Psalm 35. We're still in the books of poetry. We're in the books of poetry. Praise God. Five books of poetry. We're not going to go through all of them. But anyway, Proverbs. Praise God. Proverbs chapter 2, verse 20 through 22 talks about prosperity. Job 36, verse 11. We use that as a reference verse. And then now we go to Psalm 35. Come on, Psalm 35, and listen to what it says. Psalm 35, look at verse 27. It says, let them shout for joy. Now notice what it says, y'all. Shout, let them shout for joy and be glad that favor my righteous cause is a condition. Yea, let them continually say, out of your continually, let the Lord be magnified. Hallelujah. You're facing trouble. You're facing something coming in. Let the Lord be magnified. Well, here I am. I am a reporter. Yes, how are you doing, Mr. Gray? Could I talk to you? I understand that you're going through a test and a trial. What do you have to say about it? Let the Lord be magnified. Praise the living God. How can you say that? You just lost a loved one. Praise the Lord. And that don't mean you just run around and go crazy, but praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm not going to be sad. I'm going to cry a tear because they're gone, but praise God. I'm still going to praise the Lord and give him glory. I'm still going to pray because the Bible says we don't weep as them who have no hope. Praise God. We know what's going on in life. We believers, we ought to know, praise God. So we don't cry like the people in the world cry, oh, they gone. Oh, I'll never see them no more and spit drop. Oh, Lord, everything gone. And they get to the casket. You ought to stop all that mess, praise God. Huh? Well, no, I love them. I love them. If you love them so much, when they open up the hole and they get ready to drop that body in there, if you love them so much, how come you don't jump in there with them? Yeah, all right. Praise God. So anyway, listen here. The Bible says, let the Lord be magnified, which have pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. Listen, you and I are going to go through things. You and I are going to experience tough times and rough times. But when you got God on your side, what I always say, you're going to make it. You're going to make it. It's the will of God for you to make it. You shall not go down. Hallelujah. Stand strong and see the salvation of the Lord. Hallelujah. So Psalm 35, 27 says, let them shout for joy and be glad that favor my righteous cause. Yea, let them continually say, let the Lord be magnified, which hath pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. All right. Proverbs chapter 3. Come on, y'all. Proverbs chapter 3. Come on, we're almost done here. Proverbs chapter 3. Look at what it says. Verse 13. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 13. Happy is the man that findeth wisdom, and the man that getteth understanding. For the merchant, and when that says happy, this is God's type of happy, which means joy. Joyous or happy is the man that findeth wisdom, and the man that getteth understanding. For the merchandise of it is better than the merchandise of silver, and the gain thereof of gold. Hallelujah. He's talking about joy. In other words, when you got the joy of the Lord, praise God, it can push you and propel you through any situation. Praise God. I've said it to you before, and I'll say it again. All of the IRS agents can be knocking on your door. They're knocking on the window. They're knocking on the back door. They're knocking on the roof to try to cut in. now we kind of get in there. Praise God. And then the bill collector's calling your phone. Hello. Yes. Do you have our car? You know, you signed the deed. You signed the thing for the car. Praise God. But it is not actually your car until you pay that last payment. Praise God. And if you don't think it is, just wait. Praise God. One night they'll come, you'll hear a tow truck. What's a tow truck coming down the street for? And they hook it up to that car that you thought was your car, got your name on it, and they haul that car up out of there. Praise God. All of them can be facing you, but the joy of the Lord is your strength. Praise God, the Bible says. So notice what it says in chapter 3, verse 13. It says, happy is the man that findeth wisdom, and the man that getteth understanding, for the merchandise of it is better than silver. And the merchandise, the gain of it, better than fine gold. Fine gold. Not gold that's rough and all beat up, but fine gold that's been in the fire and brought back out. It's had all the dross knocked all off, all the sediments and all of it that are mixed up in the gold when it first comes out the ground. All of that has been moved out, and it's just fine gold, almost to the fact you could see your face in. Listen here, wisdom. Happy is the man that has the wisdom of God. Why? Because they know, listen here, God's on my side. The Lord is with me. You can take my car, you can take my house, but listen, you can't take God from me. God is with me. And listen, I'm getting ready to go to jail. Praise the Lord. Can I tell you something? Some of God's best people have been to jail. Dr. Martin Luther King went to jail. Hallelujah. Peter was in jail. Come on, y'all. Paul was in jail. He was locked, stocked, and barreled in jail. Praise God. They crucified Christ. Praise God. Do you think they were saying, oh, we can't make it at all? I don't know. The Bible says that Peter and Paul and Silas began to sing. They said, listen here, we locked up. Praise God. And do you not know in that time their feet were locked up and their hands were locked up, but their mouth wasn't locked up. They still had the joy of the Lord, and they began to sing. I don't know what they sang, y'all. They probably said, bless that wonderful name of Jesus. Bless that wonderful name of Jesus. They said, God's not dead. He's yet. And the Bible says, check the Bible out. It's in the book of Acts, praise God. The Bible says, hallelujah. God heard him. God heard him because he sees everything and hears everything. God reached down, the Bible says, and there was an earthquake. It shook the whole jail. Shook the jail and opened up all kind of prison doors, praise God, and loosed, hallelujah, Paul and Silas. What you talking about? Can I tell you something about the joy of the Lord? The joy of the Lord can get you out of the prison that you in. David was praying and he said, Lord, deliver my soul from prison. Can I tell you something that people need joy today? I'm not talking about happiness. I'm talking about the joy of the Lord because it is your strength. Your wife could have just walked out on you. Your husband could leave you. Your children could say, listen, we don't want to be your kids no more. Matter of fact, we're changing our last name. Praise God. You can still have joy because the joy of the Lord is your strength. All right. Proverbs chapter 12. Come on, y'all. I didn't give you a scripture for to go along with joy with Proverbs chapter 3. So Nehemiah chapter 8 verse 10. Write that down. And then 1 Chronicles chapter 16. Verse 26 through 28, all right? Joy, joy, joy. God wants us to have the joy. I got joy, 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 joy down in my heart, down in my heart, down in my heart. I got the joy, 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 joy down in my heart. It's the joy of the Lord that's going to see you through. Praise the living God. All right, last verse, Proverbs chapter 12, verse 21. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 21. Come on. Look at what it says. Chapter 12, verse 21. There shall no evil happen to the just, but the wicked shall be filled with mischief. There shall no evil, says evil. Praise God. Doesn't mean you won't go through a test or a trial. You will still go through, we will go through tests and trials. Don't think, Jesus said, in the world you will have tribulation. But listen, he says, I have overcome the world. Praise God. I am, because Christ is in my life. And if you know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, He's in your life, you are automatically an overcomer. Automatically an overcomer. So notice what it says. Verse 21, there shall no evil happen to the just. I want to send a shout out to Minister Colise there in Texas. God bless you. Good to see you. There shall no evil happen to the just, but the wicked shall be filled with mischief. It just automatically comes upon the wicked. Praise God. Wicked. I listen here. Stay away. And so the book of Proverbs is talking to us about the wicked and the evil and the strange woman and the harlot or the hoe. And it's talking to us about the cruelty and whatever. And so here it says, there shall no evil happen to the just. Those are the just are those who have been declared righteous by God. And the only way you get declared righteous by God is you've been washed in the blood of the Lamb. Jesus Christ has signed your name. To go along with that, we're talking about the goodness of God. To go along with that, 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verse 34. I'm going to read that right quick. It's almost time to close here. Chapter 16, verse 34 says, oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for He is good, for His mercy endureth forever. The goodness of the Lord. We're talking about the goodness of the Lord. Praise God. There shall no evil happen to the just, but the wicked shall be filled with mischief. Why is this that there shall no evil happen to the just? Because of the goodness of God. God's goodness comes upon and comes through the life of the believer, praise God. Ezra chapter 3, Ezra, Nehemiah, Ezra, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon. Ezra, look at chapter 3, look at verse 11. And they sang together by the course in praising and giving thanks unto the Lord, because He is good, for His mercy endureth forever toward Israel. In other words, when it was talking here in the book of Proverbs, verse 21 in chapter 12, there shall no evil happen to the just. In other words, God's goodness will cover them. Mercy. Listen here. I don't know about you, but we were driving back from Michigan, praise God, a couple of weeks ago, last month, praise God, coming back from Michigan. And listen here, trucks was all flying past us. The rain was falling, praise God. We saw people in accidents, praise God. But how were we able to make it back safely? The mercy of God. God's goodness watched over and kept that car, praise God, and kept us all along the way. It wasn't good driving skills. It wasn't because both headlights were working. It wasn't because, listen here, we were driving under the speed limit. It was the mercy of God that was keeping us. And so verse 11 of Ezra chapter 3, they sang together by course in praising and giving thanks unto the Lord. When was the last time you sang praises unto the Lord? When was the last time you thanked the Lord? I'm not talking about, Lord, pass the teeth and through the gums. Look out, stomach, here it comes, because you're getting ready to eat your food. Now we praise you, Lord, and thank you for this food which we're about to receive. No, I'm not talking about for your meal. I'm talking about that the Lord has been merciful and seen you through. Well, I haven't been through any danger. Listen, did you drive a car today? Did you walk outside today? Listen, do you know how many people have gotten killed in driving, or people got killed in an airplane, or people got ran over, or a dog came out and mauled it? The mercy of God kept you. The mercy of God. You and I have lived stupid. You and I have done some dumb things in our life, praise God. Listen here, it's just been nothing but the mercy of God that has kept us. Nothing but the goodness of God that has seen us through. All right, I got to wrap this up here. Let me finish this verse. And they sang together by course in praising and giving thanks unto the Lord. This is the group of Israelites that Ezra led back to the land to build up the temple of God and get their nation back going again after they were in exile, after they had been exiled and put away. Now they travel back. They didn't have any army to bring them back safely. It was nothing but the mercy of God, nothing but the goodness of God. So they say here in verse 11, and they sang together by chorus in praising and giving thanks to the Lord, because he is good, for his mercy is good to Israel. And all the people shouted with a good shout when they praised the Lord, because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. Oh, hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. You might not be laying the foundation of a physical building, but listen here. When you lay the foundation of growth in God, you're laying a foundation, praise God. We are the church. We are the house of the Lord. My body is the temple of the Holy Ghost. And so, praise God, when the temple floor was laid, they began to praise God and glorify God and remember how God had blessed them. Praise God. Down through the years, you ought to have that praise time in your life. You ought to have that thanksgiving time in your life, praise God. Every day, you ought to take some time and praise the Lord. Every day, you ought to take that time and glorify God, magnify, lift your hands and just, Lord, I thank you. Lord, I praise you. Lord, I glorify you. Lord, you're worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. All right, we're going to continue with the book of Proverbs on next week. I look to see you all on Sunday. The Lord say the same. I appreciate each and every one of you, those who have tuned in. Sister Susan, God bless you. Brother Steve Miner, Brother Brickhouse, God bless you. Brother Minister Coley's Ushery, Apostle John Evans, praise God. Minister Derek Franklin, Pastor and Minister Terry Benjamin, my good friend. So many people have tuned in. Don't forget to share this. Please share this. Let's get this out. Love you all. Tell Sister Brickhouse, I missed her. Praise God. Love you all. I appreciate each and every one of you. Praise God. If you need the, as I said, I sent out the Bible study sheets. Praise God. Go over them. Look over the scripture. Meditate on them. Chew on them. Praise God. And let's continue to grow in the Lord. Come on, let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you and praise you. I love each and every one of our people, Lord God. We thank you for what you're doing in our lives, how you're blessing us. Thank you, God, for every visitor and every person just watching. I just thank you, God, for what you're doing. Master, we come before you tonight to ask you, God, for wisdom. Lord God, you said in your word to ask for the best, Lord God, of what you have. And we ask you for wisdom. Lord, every good and perfect gift that cometh down from you, Lord God, we thank you for and praise you for. And Lord God, we come today, not with our head hanging down low, but we come with the joy of the Lord in our hearts. And we thank you because you have been merciful to us. You have blessed us. You have exceeded, Lord God, all that we could ask or think. And we just praise you and thank you for it. And Lord God, I pray that you would bless the homes that are represented here tonight. Bless the ministries, Lord God, the pastors and preachers and my friends in the gospel. God bless and touch. And I pray that you'd increase their reach and increase their growth in the name of Jesus. May the hand of God be upon them. Lord, I praise you for the Brickhouses. I praise you for the Miners. I praise you for Sister Susan. I praise you, Lord God, for them and ask you, God, to cover them with the blood. May the hand of God be with them. Lord, I pray that you would prosper and heal them. Lord, touch the Miners. Touch that family and keep them. Lord God, we thank you and give you the praise. In Jesus' mighty name, amen and amen.